Good evening. And welcome. I'm Trevor Morrison. I'm the dean of this place. It's a real pleasure to welcome you all to the second installation of the NYU Leadership Series in Law and Business and the first one of this academic year. This series brings to the law school innovative leaders in the world of law and business to share ideas, advice, and stories about their careers. It's part of a broader effort that, among other things, seeks to provide our students with models for leadership that they can emulate as they launch their own careers. It's a collaboration among several entities, including the Mitchell Jacobson Leadership Program in Law and Business, which is run by Jerry Rosenfeld and Helen Scott, the Pollack Center for Law and Business, founded by Bill Allen and now co-directed by Steve Choi here at the Law School and David Yermak at the Stern School of Business, as well as, of course, the Office of Development and Alumni Relations here at the Law School. I'm grateful to all of them for their collaboration on this event. I also want to recognize in particular and to thank the Executive Director of the Law and Business Initiatives, and that's Karen Brenner, for her tireless work on this and so many other initiatives in this area. As you can see by the great turnout tonight, this is a community interested in the intersection of law and business, and a law school that prides itself on entrepreneurship and innovation in all senses of those words. We're dedicated to encouraging and fostering that interest, including through talks like this one, between really two terrific leaders. It's not really my job tonight formally to introduce them, that comes later, but I'll just say that Larry Thompson has had a truly spectacular and diverse career in both the public and private sectors. He's managed to do it all, and to do it all very successfully, including having a wonderful family who's here tonight, and so I look forward to hearing his story. The person who will draw that story out of him is our own NYU Law alumna and trustee, Sara Moss. Sara's a wonderful leader in law and business and a terrific role model for our students. We're grateful for the many ways that she shares her knowledge and expertise with our community, and we're fortunate to count her as a leading member of the law school family. My immediate job tonight, though, is to introduce Professor Helen Scott, who will formally introduce Sara. Helen, as I mentioned, co-directs the Mitchell Jacobson Leadership Program in Law and Business, and together with her co-director, Jerry Rosenfeld, she has done great things to grow the program and inspire our students to pursue exciting careers in law, in business, and at the intersection of the two. Helen teaches in the areas of corporate governance and contracts, among others. She's developed distinctive courses, such as a seminar in business transactions planning, which is our first non-litigation-based full-scale simulation course here at the law school. And she's helped to mount a number of other transactions-based deals courses as well, which are a very exciting part of the new law and business curriculum that we've been developing here at the law school. Helen is really a terrific asset to the law school and a great resource to me as I get started here as dean, and I'm glad she's here tonight to introduce Sara. So without further ado, Helen Scott.
Thanks very much, Trevor. Of course, I am delighted to be here. This is the second of our new series on conversations on leadership. This is one of the law and business initiatives we are undertaking here at NYU. Trevor has mentioned some of them. It's a wide-ranging set of programs, courses, events, discussions, and a clinic, which reflect our belief in the benefits of expanding our students' ability to navigate the global business world at the intersection of law and business, which is where our students increasingly find themselves located in their professional lives, or the direction in which they want to move. The leadership series, this particular series, is one of the ways that we recognize that our graduates are, and one day many of our students will be, in significant positions of leadership that will require them to develop new skills, to think outside of legal doctrine and rules, and we want to help them understand how this process develops in people who have so exemplified the skills necessary to be effective leaders. Tonight, we are very fortunate indeed to have two conversants who are each and both wonderful examples of lawyers who are leaders in the profession. My particular job and my particular pleasure is to introduce Sara Moss, who will introduce and interview Larry Thompson. Sara is currently the Executive Vice President and General Counsel of the Estée Lauder Companies. She has wide-ranging responsibilities for the worldwide legal activities of the company and its subsidiaries, board of directors, corporate governance, acquisitions, U.S. and global filings, government relations, intellectual property, you may wonder why I'm reading this, intellectual property, licensing, and global security. This is an example of the kinds of broad-ranging, both managerial, legal, and operational expertise that our graduates are going to be asked to bring to bear on a wide range of problems, some of which we know about today and some of which will develop long after our students have left the law school. Sara is a wonderful example of someone whose career has progressed into a broader and broader and broader world. Before joining Estée Lauder, Sara was the general counsel at Pitney Bowes, which she joined after being a partner at a law firm. She had before that been a prosecutor in the Southern District of New York. Now, I don't want you to think because Sara was a prosecutor and Larry Thompson was in the Justice Department that we are focused unduly on the criminal side of the law and business. We are not. But we do understand that there's a wide range of issues that people have to deal with when they start entering this global business world. Sara has received numerous awards, including the Anti-Defamation League Human Rights Award and the Now Legal Defense and Education Fund Aiming High Award. Most importantly, Sara is a really active member of the NYU Law School community. She is a member of the Board of Trustees. She sits on the advisory board of the Jacobson Leadership Program in Law and Business. She is a dedicated friend of ours and a dedicated supporter of our leadership and our law and business initiatives. She's been an active and generous mentor to our students. She's hired a number of them in summer positions for which we are always very happy. And of course, if any of you are interested in having NYU law students, please do not hesitate to let us know. They are an extraordinary resource. Smart, energetic, well, I could go on, but. Suffice it to say that Sara has excelled in any role in which I have known her. I've known her for a long time. She's lectured and guest lectured in courses I've taught for many, many years, and is always, as you will surely see, a great favorite with the students. You will certainly see why as you join me in welcoming Sara Moss.
I'm going to try to stand here. I'm a little short for the podium, so thank you, Helen. This evening is about Larry Thompson, and it really is my extraordinary pleasure and privilege to introduce Larry and then to just chat with him, with all of you. Larry is an extraordinary leader in law, in business, and in government. And I think when you learn about his career, probably many of you already know about his career, it is really spectacular. Larry is Executive Vice President, Government Affairs, General Counsel, and Corporate Secretary at Pepsi. And in that capacity, he has a very wide range of duties, my duties, the duties that Helen described, plus more. And he's also a very close and trusted advisor, business advisor to the CEO, Indra Nooyi. Larry was general counsel of Pepsi for a number of years until he retired in 2011, but they couldn't live without him, and so they brought him back, and he came back last year and is in that capacity and more. Larry's career truly is extraordinary in the private sector and in the public sector. I don't want to miss anything, but it is in my head because it's so amazing. In the private sector, he was a partner at King & Spalding in Georgia, in Atlanta, obviously at Pepsi. He was a senior fellow at the Brookings Institute and also a professor at the University of Georgia in the John Sibley Chair of Corporate and Business Law. So he has done all of that. But in addition to all of that, I think probably he's best known for his contributions and leadership in government. Larry was the United States Attorney for the Northern District of Georgia. He was independent counsel for housing and urban development. And then in 2001, he was named Deputy Attorney General of the United States. Certainly gonna ask him to tell us about it, but he was Deputy Attorney General during 9/11, and I think that was an extraordinary experience. And then named the chair of the Department of Justice National Security Coordination Council, which I hope he'll tell us about, after 9/11. He was also the chair of the Corporate Fraud Task Force, in his capacity as Deputy Attorney General, and has made a really big impact in law enforcement and in really so many ways that are important to the government. Larry has gone back and forth between government and private sector, always successfully, always with more responsibility and a wider breadth of responsibility and knowledge. Larry has written many articles. I think hopefully they're in the program, and has spoken in many different forums. And again, I hope that is in the program. I really cannot think of a better leader in law, in business, with integrity, brilliance, and somebody who I've admired for my whole career. We're really lucky to have Larry Thompson here with us tonight. So, Larry, if you'd come up, let's talk.
Thank you.
I want you to know we're drinking Pepsi Aquafina here, the only kind that's allowed. the thought here is that we would chat for a little while and then have plenty of time for questions. So Larry, since we're alone here. Kierkegaard said, I thought about this when I thought about our conversation. Life must be lived forward, but understood backwards. And you really have had an unbelievable career in the private sector, public sector, and you've gone back and forth. Talk a little bit about the reasons you think, your reasons for such success.
Well, that's interesting, and thank you for that wonderful introduction. It made me, I'm only 67 years old, but after listening to all that, I thought I must have been 80. Sara, you know, a lot of people will say things in response to your question that you're just lucky, and I think I've just been lucky. I was lucky to have two great parents who neither one of them graduated from high school, but they instilled a lot of great values and a work ethic in me, which I think has been very important. In the law, I was lucky to be able to work with a number of really, really terrific lawyers. Dick Duesenberg, who I think was a professor here at NYU at one time, he was one of my first bosses, if you will, at Monsanto Company when I was a young lawyer at Monsanto. I had probably, and this was a function of luck, I had probably one of the greatest mentors any lawyer could ever have with Griffin Bell, who had a tremendous impact on my career.
How did that happen?
I'll just tell you the story. I joined Monsanto right out of the University of Michigan Law School. Monsanto is a big company, big corporation in St. Louis, Missouri. I was born and raised in Hannibal, Missouri, and I thought it just natural for me to return to Missouri and start my law practice. And I joined Monsanto, even though I had two or three law firms in St. Louis recruiting me. I joined Monsanto simply because they offered the most money at the time. And one of the few times in my career I've taken a job for money.
I know you said don't do that, so we'll get back to that.
But at Monsanto, I started off in the corporate department, realized very early on that I wanted to be a litigator and that I really wanted to go into a law firm. And I happened to meet a young lawyer who was also at Monsanto with me, who was from Georgia. And I was working with the law firm King & Spalding on a case. I was the Monsanto representative. And I told them I was going to leave, although I was going to leave to go to this firm in St. Louis. And the King & Spalding lawyer said, well, we didn't know you were thinking about leaving. If you're going to leave, why don't you join our firm in Atlanta? I had no intention of going to Atlanta. And I happened to have lunch with this young lawyer. And he persuaded me to go to Atlanta because he thought it would be a much better place to practice law as a young lawyer. That young lawyer has gone on to bigger and better things, and his name is Clarence Thomas.
Clarence Thomas was a lawyer at King & Spalding?
He was a lawyer at Monsanto with me.
Oh.
Early on. And so I go to King & Spalding and end up working with Griffin Bell when he was the Attorney General of the United States in Jimmy Carter's administration, and he returned to King & Spalding, and I worked with him for a number of years. So that's how that connection happened.
That's fascinating. Now, you went to Michigan Law School.
Yes.
And there are a number of law students here. Was there anything in the law school experience that you think was powerful?
Yeah. By the way, I went to Michigan Law School, but I have a connection, direct connection to NYU, because my son is a graduate of NYU Law School. And as you were introducing, I were thinking, Helen, as you were going through some of the people here in your program over the years as general counsel at PepsiCo, Bill Allen has been one of my terrific advisors on corporate governance matters. So I feel strong connection to NYU. And we'll talk about this, but I had a professor at Michigan by the name of Joe Vining, who really was, he taught corporate law, he taught law and philosophy, but he really introduced me to this concept called corporate criminal liability, and it was something that I was interested in 1973 when I took his class, and it's something that has been a part of my career on and off for the past 39 years. But it really was through a professor. It's really interesting when you're at a fine school like NYU, you have great students, you have great faculty, and it's really interesting, not that I was a terrific student, but when one mind as a student meets another mind as a faculty member, and the two minds come together, really lots of things can happen. And certainly I owe a great deal to some of the things that I've been interested in the law to Professor Joe Vining, who recently retired from the University of Michigan.
I know your commencement speech mentioned him. So you talked about some people, but were there any experiences early on in your career that you think were the most valuable as a foundation for your success?
That's a good question. One of the things that Griffin Bell always not only told me, but told all the lawyers, young lawyers at King & Spalding, that, you know, sort of three things that were important. Number one, take care of your clients. He was very big on making certain that you returned phone calls, did the work you had to do for the benefit of your client. Number two was sort of nourish your development as a lawyer, nourish your career as a lawyer. And number three was to value your reputation. And I took all three of those to heart then. I still take all three of those to heart today. And I got involved in a political campaign, and law and politics go together, as you know. And I got involved in a political campaign in 1980. My candidate won, the first time a Republican won a statewide race in Georgia since Reconstruction. And this was in 1980. And immediately a group of people in Atlanta wanted me to apply for the United States Attorney position. I declined to do so because, number one, I didn't think I would make any money at it. Number two, I didn't think I was qualified. And number three, I wanted to become a partner at King & Spalding. Well, through a series of events, that job never was filled. And then you fast forward to 1982. The newspapers in Atlanta were very critical of the Reagan administration for not filling that job. And one day, Judge Bell came into my office and in his southern accent said to me, if you really want to amount to anything in the law, you should take this job. I took the job, I will never forget this, because as a senior associate at King & Spalding, I was making $57,000 a year. The United States attorney position paid $55,000 a year. So that was the first of several pay cuts I've taken in my legal career.
So how did you, you had not been an assistant U.S. attorney, right?
No.
How did you come into the U.S. attorney's position and learn that and be successful without the criminal prosecution background?
Well, one of the things is back then in large law firms, you were able to get trial experience as an associate, sometimes by yourself. And so I had a number of warranty cases for automobile manufacturers that I'd handled in lower courts in Atlanta. But what the other thing was, I had a curiosity, and again, Professor Vining's name comes into the picture here. I had a curiosity about criminal law. I was working on some criminal antitrust cases, and they're very detailed. I had become very, very familiar with the federal rules of criminal procedure, and I volunteered for work in the Federal Defender's Office in Atlanta. And I was on the B panel, which is misdemeanors, not the A panel for felonies. I didn't have any experience, and so I couldn't get on the A panel. I got on the B panel and was assigned a very complex case, a habeas case involving allegations of ineffective assistance of counsel. The counsel involved was a very famous criminal defense lawyer in Atlanta. It required hearings before a United States magistrate judge. He thought I had done pretty good. And when the Atlanta newspapers sort of were snooping around and were about ready to write an article critical of my lack of trial experience, especially federal trial experience, this magistrate judge spoke up and said, well, he'd been in my courtroom and he did a great job. And all of that went away.
That's great. What were some of your successes as United States Attorney? What are the things that you wanted to accomplish that you did?
Well, I'd had a great background in a large law firm, and prior to my appointment, many of the U.S. attorneys had come from fairly traditional political patronage jobs. I'd had a background working in a large law firm. I think we were able to bring, and I want to use the word we because it was a team effort. We were able to bring a degree of sophistication, if you will, to the approach of legal problems that perhaps some of the prior leaders in that office had not had. I had a lot of great lawyers working with me. At the time, this was the advent of the drug enforcement issues that Rudy Giuliani, who was the Associate Attorney General of the United States at the time, was involved with President Reagan and Attorney General William Smith. And so we were able to do a lot of good things in that area, as well as some other civil rights law enforcement. We had one of the first successful prosecutions of the Ku Klux Klan in Georgia ever. And so I think we were able to make some very significant contributions to the justice system.
Definitely. One of the pleasures for me in doing this was getting to read some of many of Larry's speeches and articles. So I just want to ask you, Larry. You've said a couple of times about the pay cut, but I know that you've written and spoken and advised lawyers not to be focused on compensation. And so I feel like tonight much of it is about your career, but also your advice to law students and to everybody here as to what you think is important in being a lawyer. And clearly it's not compensation, right? Do you want to talk about that for a minute?
Well, you told me you were going to ask me that. one of the few things you told me you were going to ask, and my advice is really very simple, and I think in terms of what has been successful and what has worked for me, number one, I would say stay close to your professors, stay close to senior partners who are in your law firms, stay close to judges before whom you appear, stay close to your friends and your fellow classmates. And I think a great deal of, I don't want to say success, but a great deal of the satisfaction in my career has been the association I've had with professors, the association I've had with senior lawyers that I've maintained, the association I've had with friends like Anthony Welters, who is a prominent citizen of this university community.
Chairman of the board of the law school, yep.
And so these are all things that I think are very, very important, and they've been very important to me. I've been in and out of public service, and the reason has been not necessarily because, you know, I think that was something I was required to do, but the reason I've been in and out of public service is because I think, going back to the advice Judge Bell gave me, it's been a way for me to nourish my professional development, and I found public service interesting and satisfying. So it's been a vehicle for me. There are other probably vehicles that other people can have, but it's been a vehicle for me to not only become a better lawyer, but also to get great satisfaction serving the public's interest.
Did you have a career plan to go back and forth between private?
I had nothing about my career plan. Not one thing.
You did very well with no plan. That's interesting. Let's turn to your tenure as Deputy Attorney General. You became Deputy Attorney General in 2001, and then, of course, there was 9/11. Can you talk a little bit about that experience for you?
Yes. I was sworn in May of 2011. I didn't know if I really wanted to take a job in the Department of Justice at that time. I was talking with my wife about whether or not I should take a job, a number two position. At the beginning, because a great deal of my career, Sarah, has been either being a prosecutor, federal prosecutor, or being a white-collar defense lawyer. So a great deal of my career, if not almost all of my career, had been dealing with the Department of Justice on one side of the table or the other. And I remember vividly having a conversation with Brenda, my wife, around June or July, saying, things are real slow. I really don't know if I like this job. It's not a lot of action here. I'm not learning a lot. I'm not learning anything new. I was going to a lot of meetings as the Deputy Attorney General, completely outside the sphere of the criminal justice system or the justice system, a lot of national security meetings, a lot of meetings on the economic development of our country, and things that I had never been associated with. And then, of course, we had the horrible day of 9/11. And there was nothing in the books where you could go to and say, what do you do when over 3,000 of your fellow citizens have been murdered? And it was an unbelievably horrific experience. I remember on that day, Condi Rice, John Ashcroft was out of town. And I remember on that day, Condi Rice called me and basically she knew that John was out of town, and she said, stay there, don't leave. And literally within 5 minutes, a whole team of United States Marshals came into my office. They basically arrested me and took me to the undisclosed location.
Can you tell us now, or is it still?
I can't tell you.
Yeah.
My son was a student at NYU. My other son was working for Tony Welters, my friend. So I had two sons in New York. And Brenda was Tony was actually getting ready to have a party for me and that night, and Brenda was there, and I couldn't really talk to Brenda until about 3 or 4 that afternoon. She had not been able to get a hold of one of my sons. She had been able to get a hold of either Tony or someone in his office who said the other son was safe, but it was a real horrific experience, and it really changed my life. It changed, I think, what has happened to this country. It certainly has changed the mission of the Department of Justice forever, because before, the Department of Justice was focused on reacting to criminal activity. You remember when the World Trade Center had been bombed previously, and immediately the FBI was called in. Immediately a criminal investigation was launched, and some people were prosecuted. But clearly we recognized we had to do something more than just react. And when people are willing to give their lives to do evil and horrific things to other people, you really have to focus on prevention. Prevention's a tough thing in the context of our society, because it does bump up against other things that we cherish. It really changed the face of the nation, certainly changed the face of the Department of Justice and its mission. And on a personal note, you know, we were all type A kind of people, and you think about things like this, and we knew in the department, because I had regular meetings with the FBI, we knew in late July, August, that something was amiss. I remember clearly having briefings where experts in counterterrorism said that there's so much noise in the system, something's going to happen. Now, of course, no one thought something was going to happen on the homeland. But one of my advisors, I kept two people from, Eric Holder, the current Attorney General, was the Deputy Attorney General, and I kept two people from Eric's staff to stay on my staff. And one of my advisors was a key national security lawyer, and he told me in August that we had to do something different about the way the CIA and the way the FBI interacted. And I actually wrote a memorandum. You've heard about the wall between intelligence and criminal information. And I actually wrote a memorandum in August, mid-August, lowering the wall between national security and FBI. And you know, as a human, you think, well, maybe if I'd done something else. But it was a really horrific event. There were a lot of good things. I remember going up on the Hill and briefing people in the Senate Intelligence Committee, and for the first time ever, there was not a Republican nor a Democrat. They're only Americans.
Yeah. That's very special. Talking about the coordination or the walls going down, I think in the 9/11 report, some of the most disturbing things, at least to me, was the lack of sharing of information. And you became the head of the National Security Coordination Council. In your capacity as Deputy Attorney General, were you able to take steps to lower that wall and improve the coordination?
And let me explain why there was the wall, by the way. It's not because these agencies were necessarily jealous of each other. There was some of that. But the reason for the wall was simply because of the kind of society we are. And so for investigations of a national security nature, the threshold is lower. Because intelligence information comes from all kinds of sources, and the way to deal with it, you deal with it in a much more informal way, if you will. However, criminal information, we as citizens, if the government wants to conduct a criminal investigation of us, it has to have probable cause. A criminal investigation of you or me cannot take place simply because of a whisper, simply because of a rumor. As you know, an assistant U.S. attorney has to go to a federal magistrate, and a magistrate has to indicate that there's probable cause to do something like search your home or to have a wiretap. So there are two different kinds of methodologies, and it was proper to try to protect American citizens from unwarranted intrusions of their privacy from criminal, on the criminal side, and where the where information on intelligence could leak over to the criminal side, and we could be improperly targeted for an investigation. That's why you had the wall. After 9/11, of course, we the wall completely collapsed, and the focus was on prevention. We didn't know what we were doing. Really, we didn't know what we were doing. But I certainly, in my responsibility, sort of erred on the side of protection. And I did not want to happen again, and certainly not on my watch, I did not want to happen again what happened in 9/11. And as we went forward, of course, you know, there are things that are presented to you that notwithstanding the focus on protection and prevention, you just couldn't do. I remember in a meeting with the Attorney General, and we were asked to think outside the box, and one of my colleagues came up with a really interesting proposal that would violate all kinds of notions of constitutional rights and so forth. And John Ashcroft said to that person, "I told you to think outside the box, but not outside of the Constitution." So there was a limit to what we were going to do. But those were tough times, and you know the country's still going. You know we're still dealing with this. Witness the debacle with the NSA. You didn't ask me this, but I'll volunteer it at least. I still have a lot of confidence in judges, and I know the FISA court has been derided a bit, but I think the judges who are appointed to that court take their jobs very seriously. I certainly don't think, even though as you and I are speaking, there's somebody around the world trying to plot to kill us, I still don't think that we can give the executive branch a blank check. But we've got to figure out how we're going to not change the essential character of this country, but continue to protect us, protect our public safety.
Do you think we're better protected today in terms of sharing information as a result of what we learned in 9/11 and some of the steps?
No question about that. No question about that. And it varies in different parts of the country. In this city, we have a tremendous local law enforcement mechanism and group that's not only expert at the regular crime, but is really expert on dealing with intelligence. And I know that NYPD works very closely with the FBI and other law enforcement agencies around the world. This is probably one of the safest places to be in that sense. But we really need to work at it, and we need to get it right as a society.
Agree completely. In your capacity as Deputy Attorney General, I think something that obviously is something you have become known for, or were known for, in your role as the head of the Corporate Fraud Task Force, mm-hmm. Principles of Federal Prosecution of Corporations, the Thompson Memo. People are studying it, or people are familiar with it. Can you just describe that a little bit, your thinking behind it, and your current thinking about attorney-client privilege and some of those issues.
So
a lot of questions at once.
And the Wall Street Journal, those of you who read the Wall Street Journal, has been and continues to be very critical of the so-called Thompson Memo. There have been iterations since it, but that newspaper calls it the Thompson Memo and its progeny. And it used to upset me, but one of my sons says, "Forget about it, Dad. It's going to be in your obituary and move on." So so I guess I'll have to deal with it. But look, what happened after 9/11 and the deployment of almost all of the federal law enforcement resources into national security and counterterrorism, you had the Enron bankruptcy. And soon after the Enron bankruptcy, you had multiple bankruptcies of public companies. There was a great deal of concern by the Federal Reserve, by the Secretary of Treasury, and by the President that if these corporate bankruptcies continued, because these bankruptcies, for all indication, were not the result of mismanagement, but really the result of fraud, widespread fraud, in the boardrooms of our country. If these things did not, if they were not checked and investigated and dealt with, we might have the kind of recession, the kind of crisis that we unfortunately experienced in 2008. So that's the backdrop. Limited resources and a very serious law enforcement problem. And what we attempted to do in the face of that was, number one, send some guidance to the assistant United States attorneys around the country as to when would you prosecute high-level executives, what are the factors you would take into consideration, but most importantly, when would you prosecute a corporation? Because there was a lot of confusion as to when would a corporation be prosecuted. A number of the corporations who were the targets of some of these investigations had simply rotten, totally rotten management, totally rotten cultures. So what do you do in the face of a corporation like that? Because you didn't want to be precipitous. You had innocent shareholders, you had innocent employees, and you had, in effect, innocent communities. So that's the one thing we were trying to do. Give guidance to the business community and give guidance to our lawyers as to when would you deal with corporate criminality. The second point, and the most important point, we needed to incent American companies to come in and cooperate with the government with respect to these issues. But the cooperation had to be authentic. And what you had in a number of instances where a company would come in, or its lawyers would come in and would say, Sara, we want to cooperate with the government. We know there was a problem over here in Division X. We've corrected it. And then if you ask the question with respect to, well, tell me what you did, Sara, I can't tell you because that's covered by the attorney-client privilege. And the question is that the kind of cooperation we wanted to deal with? And so I called it authentic cooperation, but what we wanted to do was sort of incent companies to cooperate, and many did. And there was an issue sometimes associated with the privilege. I probably wouldn't have used the word waiver if I had to write that memo again. But the waiver was number one in the memo. It was supposed to occur only in limited circumstances. And number two, it was dealing with factual information, not legal advice. It was misinterpreted, and perhaps some of my friends in the defense bar said that a lot of prosecutors misused that. So be that as it may, it became very controversial. But you do need, as a citizen, I just want to not just say as a general counsel or someone who's been in business now for a long time, but as a citizen, you do want to address law enforcement problems. In 2002, we had a serious law enforcement problem. It wasn't in the streets, but it was in boardrooms all across our country. Corporate governance had run amok in some instances. There were too many cozy relationships between managements and boards. There was too much fraud going on between CFOs and audit committees. People were making up numbers. Hundreds of CFOs, CEOs were prosecuted and successfully prosecuted during that time period, and many of them went to jail. I think what we did in the Corporate Fraud Task Force was important. I think it helped restore a sense of justice in our country, and certainly helped send a message to the American people that you're not going to get away with criminality, whether you are a low-level person or a high corporate executive. And cooperation is needed. As you know, Sara, in law enforcement, and especially in white-collar matters, cooperation is the mother's milk of good law enforcement, and you have to have ways to incent cooperation. And I think the steps we took were important steps. They were appropriate steps. They were legally sound steps. And quite frankly, they were successful because a lot of people, a lot of the executives who were engaged in these bad activities were sent to justice, got their justice.
You talked in this regard about the responsible corporation, and mm-hmm. you've written about that, the tone at the top and the responsible corporation. Can you just elaborate on that a little bit?
So as you mentioned in your introduction to me, I have a wonderful boss. And Indra has a management principle in terms of the way PepsiCo is run, and she calls it performance with purpose. And she believes it's very important for a company, especially a consumer-oriented company like PepsiCo, to not only perform, but to perform well on a number of dimensions. For example, with respect to our products, try to make them healthier. With respect to the environment, we use a lot of water, try to take care of the environment. And with respect to people, treat your people correctly. And this is all a part of performance. This is not social responsibility, corporate philanthropy. This is all a part of the way we are supposed to conduct our business. There were cynics to this, and one day she called me into the office and said, can you give me, make certain I understand the legal bases for performance with purpose, which was a really interesting thing to ask a general counsel. Usually we are asked to do a deal, win a case, mm-hmm. things like that, do the proper filings, but to ask about the legal principles associated with a management direction I thought was very telling. And I was going back to Professor Viney. I did call upon an outside law firm to give me an initial memo. I didn't like the memo, and so I undertook to do some of the research myself. And that was the beginning of my interest in that. And if you go back, those of you who have have taken corporations course, some of this starts with the famous phrase that Milton Friedman articulated in 1970, which was in response to some other things, but he said that the only responsibility a corporation has, the only responsibility that management of a corporation has, is to maximize profits to its shareholders. And that was said in 1970, and it's followed by a number of people, even today. And the issue is, are there other constituencies of a corporation, a business corporation, a for-profit corporation, that are important? Like, for example, your employees, your customers, your consumers, the environment. And so this has been a debate in corporate law, and that's been the focus of some of my research. And just one takeaway from that is, you shouldn't look at it as a zero-sum game. I think in today's world, corporations and society need each other. They're interdependent. Society gets a lot of things from corporations. Many people in society, they get jobs, they get wealth. People get great products and great services. So society is better if corporations perform. Corporations get a great deal from society. We get healthy people, educated people. We get the ability to do business in the corporate form, which, as you know, is a benefit. And finally, we use a lot of natural resources, and we get that from society. And I don't think that society and corporations are necessarily adversaries. I think they're interdependent, and that's been the focus of not only my research, but the focus of how we're trying to run PepsiCo.
Well, at Pepsi, you play a business role and a legal role. Can you just describe generally the scope of your duties, and I think particularly the business role as well?
Well, I often get asked, what is it like being the general counsel of a company like PepsiCo that does business in about 180 countries and has almost 300,000 people? And my response is, well, I sleep like a baby. I wake up in the middle of the night screaming.
Me too, I'll call you up. I know that.
It's a tough job. Yeah. We do business all around the world. And as you know, for general counsel specifically and for business in general, things have gotten more complex, and unfortunately for us, especially the GCs, they've gotten more prescriptive. And things are more complex because we have all kinds of rules and regulations, all kinds of expectations on the part of society for business. You know, businesses are expected to be profitable, competitive, generous, socially responsible, diverse, all kinds of expectations on businesses. And so things are becoming more complex. One of the issues I have with my job is to make certain that our leaders in the company and the board, that we do not have some kind of checklist mentality and avoid the kinds of things that take time away from the boards and the leaders doing what they need to do, which is set the strategic direction of the company. But it's hard when we have all these complexities. It's gotten more prescriptive, and this is what bothers me. It's gotten more prescriptive because, especially with the advent of Dodd-Frank, there are a number of statutes that have been adopted that govern business conduct, and there is no way of telling that if you violate the statute, you've had a civil violation or you have a criminal violation and you can go to jail. There's no way of telling. As you know, many of these statutes, the whole concept that we learned in our first year criminal law class, mens rea, right, an evil mind, the concept of mens rea has been read out of these statutes. You don't know if you violate a statute, is it a civil violation or is it a criminal violation? So things have gotten more prescriptive. And the job, I think, of a general counsel has gotten more complex and, unfortunately, more dangerous from a personal standpoint.
What are your biggest challenges as general counsel?
I think the biggest challenge I have is to make certain that the senior management of the company and the board are free to go about running the company and growing value for our shareholders and doing the kind of things that's going to continue to make PepsiCo a great company, and try to not allow the senior people in the company to get mired in all these complex and vague regulations. And quite frankly, to step up and take the heat on some of the prescriptive things where they are relying on me to make certain that they stay out of trouble.
Now, you left Pepsi, you retired in 2011, and then you came back in 2012. What's up with that?
What is up with that? I'm trying to figure that one out myself.
I'm trying to know. And how did they persuade you to come back? So tell us about that.
Well, when I left, I was 65. And we had just finished two huge acquisitions, one in Russia. You can imagine what an acquisition in Russia is about. And then one here, which was the first major deal of the Obama administration and the Obama administration FTC, where PepsiCo moved to acquire its public company bottlers, two big companies. And I was tired. These deals were complex in different ways. I was tired. I thought it was time to retire. That's what we're supposed to do when you turn 65. And, you know, I don't know if I did such a good job at retiring. I was very busy.
You had a chair at the University of Georgia Law School, right?
I was
which,
teaching part-time.
I'll tell you, it's no picnic, right?
I was teaching. No, that is no picnic, by the way. I was teaching part-time, and as you know, especially the first time, you cannot walk into a law school class with 35 or even 20 bright students and BS your way through an hour. That is just not going to happen. And so you had to work real hard preparing for class, and I enjoyed it. But lingering on, as we live longer, I think all of us are going to have to deal with this. You when you've been doing something for as long as I did, and the phone ringing every morning, being responsible for lots of things, and when you've been doing it as long as I had been doing it, and then all of a sudden you're doing something else. And that something else was tough in its own way, but not anything that I was familiar with. There's a certain trepidation. There's a certain sense, well, am I still relevant? And no, you know, we don't want to be irrelevant. And so, yeah, and then of course, I continued to talk to Indra, and she is a friend. And so what was up was when Indra asked me to come back for legitimate reasons, I did it, because that's what we lawyers do. We support our clients.
Absolutely. I want to leave time for questions. So let me ask you just finally, last question, is what advice would you have for law students, for people starting their career or at any point in their career? Somebody suggested that I ask you to give a commencement speech for law students, and mm-hmm. what would that entail? And I know you have given commencement speeches.
I have.
Because I've read them, so they're great. But what, given your extraordinary mm-hmm. career, what is your advice?
Well, first of all, as I said previously, stay connected with each other, stay connected with your professors, with senior lawyers in your firms. If you happen to practice, as I did early in my career, before judges, stay connected with judges. That's number one. So we're at NYU Law School. You have a tremendous graduate that I want to repeat some advice that he gave to lawyers, because you remember what Judge Bell said to me was value your reputation. So Elihu Root is a graduate of NYU, probably one of the most prominent graduates of NYU. He did a lot of things, but on the point of valuing your reputation, he said that about half the practice of a decent lawyer is telling his clients that they're damn fools and should stop.
Good luck with that, right? I think that's great. Let's wrap up, if we could, and ask for questions. Larry, thank you so much. I mean, you really are a role model for all of us, and extraordinary. So thank you. I think we do have time for questions. So please, I think people will bring around microphones. These are questions for Larry. I'll just sort of point to.
Or you can ask one to Sara too.
No. I didn't sign up for that.
The first part of your question, and it's based on my observation as in private practice representing companies, and now as a public company general counsel. I actually think today most public companies or large private companies are doing a better job at complying with laws and regulations and establishing integrity systems. Because, number one, not because people have gotten more honest, but because there are tremendous incentives to do so and tremendous sanctions if you don't do so through things like the organizational sentencing guidelines, et cetera. So, and more of an emphasis, especially on federal law enforcement, on business. So I actually think companies are doing a better job than they did in the past. However, as we saw in a fairly recent time in 2002, things are not always perfect. And certainly in 2002, we had a huge crisis in corporate governance. And lots of things were amiss, and we had lots of things that did harm to our economy. In terms of, repeat the second? Yes. Right. That's a really interesting question. That's a really interesting question, because I think federal prosecutors are like a lot of us. You know, by and large, most of the ones that, you know, we've dealt with are very professional and good. There's some malevolent ones. What happens, though, when you have a malevolent prosecutor as you're on the other side as a corporation, there's not a lot you can do. If you and I are the subject of a malevolent criminal investigation, at some point we can decide, especially if we are fortunate enough to have the money to support a defense, we can decide that, okay, I'm going to go to trial. This is wrong. I didn't do what you are accusing me of doing, and I'm going to try this case. You know, a corporation today with respondeat superior and a malevolent prosecutor leveraging something that bad that happened with one employee to the entire company, A corporation today really, really has a very hard time in going, being able to go to trial. And so what happens is you have a lot of results that are leveraged against companies when in fact the company had one or two bad employees, and when in fact the company was doing everything it possibly could to make certain that it complied with the law and had proper integrity systems. You know, I wrote an article and gave a speech at Georgetown Law School about this dilemma that we have, because we haven't figured out respondeat superior in today's world, where you have tough federal law and criminal law enforcement and this antedated notion of respondeat superior. And I called my speech "The Blameless Corporation." Well, the kids went nuts. They didn't think a corporation could ever be blameless. But when you think about it, if you do everything you possibly can, my employer, we have almost 300,000 employees. Do you know of any city, any group of people in the world with 300,000 employees without a police force? It doesn't happen. And people are either going to be stupid, or people are going to do something that you don't want them to do. And is it fair in that situation to hold a corporation responsible when it's done everything the law and regulations say it should be doing to set up these gold-plated compliance and integrity programs? These things are very expensive. They're very expensive to implement and very expensive to administer. So there are some issues with respect to the rights of corporations, because under certain circumstances, as we all know with the famous Citizens United case, corporations can be persons.
Right. Yep. Rachel?
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
You referred to Milton Friedman and the fact that many lawyers believe that a corporation's role is to maximize profits for its shareholders, but that you advised your CEO on the legal principles that would support a broader role for the corporation in society. Mm-hmm. Could you talk about why you think there are so few U.S. corporations who are leading in this way, who you think the other leaders are, and how we can encourage more leaders, more lawyers, to take the leadership role that you have?
To directly answer your question, the problem really doesn't lie in our profession, if you will, in terms of what I call maximizing profits of shareholders. The problem really is not too far from us here, and it's on Wall Street. Many corporations are faced with the dilemma, if you will, of managing on a 90-day cycle, quarter-to-quarter earnings. This is a very important thing in the way, especially U.S. corporations, are managed. This is something that I don't think any CEO can afford to ignore. They're human, and it focuses on short-term behavior. And what I advised my CEO was to, broaden the horizon of constituents in which we manage the company for, including our consumers, our customers, the environment. You have to have a social license to operate. There many beverage companies in India and other parts of the world cannot even get a license to build a new plant, or cannot even open a plant that has been closed because of the shortage of water. So if you don't keep your mind focused on other constituencies, bad things are going to happen to the company, and bad things then will happen to your shareholders. The other thing is that we need to extend our timeline by which we measure success of a business, and it's got to be beyond 90 days. It just simply has to be beyond 90 days. And so that's the other issue. You asked me a very complicated question. Why is this happening? We've really got to look at corporate law. Aspen Institute has done some really good work in this regard, because the fact of the matter is there's an ambiguity in corporate law today. A shareholder is a shareholder is a shareholder. There are a number of shareholders that will hold a stock in a large company like PepsiCo because our returns over a number of years are fairly consistent and predictable. So they want to hold a stock like a company like PepsiCo to maximize the benefits for their pensioners and the people who invest. But there are shareholders who legitimately, because a shareholder is a shareholder is a shareholder, who could buy a stock and would say, I only want to hold this stock for a month. And I want the management of the company to do whatever it takes to make a lot of money for me in a month. You know, I think that shareholder certainly legally is just as entitled to his or her expectations as the other shareholder. So what the Aspen Institute has done is to consider ways that we can reform either corporate governance policies or our tax code to incent shareholders to hold for a longer period of time. And the reason that is important is that American companies really compete not only against each other, but we compete against companies from Japan and other parts of Asia, European companies that really don't have the 90-day pressure that we have and who can afford to take the long-term view and I think can better compete on the long term than with American companies. So, you know, that's why, you know, I think that this is an open issue, but you have to, like what I think my CEO has done, you have to be a leader. And I think some of the things that we have done, you know, witness what happened in this city with respect to beverages and the dispute about the size of beverages, the size of a cup of Pepsi. And you have to deal with these issues, these public policy issues, and it was good for us to make our products and try to make our products healthier. And I think our investors understand that that was good. And so the company has been doing pretty good from a stock price.
That's great. Probably one more if there's, yeah, sir?
Thank you for an interesting talk. I'll make one really quick. It seems like the market for legal services and lawyers is changing pretty dramatically, and that a lot of that's being driven by client cost sensitivity. How much is that part of your job?
Yes. That.
Two to that, since we only have one question, so we'll just consolidate. somewhat related question is, besides subject matter expertise, when you're recruiting senior level attorneys at your company, or lower level that your senior attorneys are recruiting, what would you consider the two or three differentiators that kind of separate one attorney from another with respect to making that employment decision? Two or three qualities that you think are very important.
Yeah, I think the cost of legal services is a real issue in our profession, and especially as it relates to the delivery of legal services to a wide range of clients beyond just companies like PepsiCo, but individuals who really can't afford good legal representation. That's a huge issue that we face in society, and I think law schools are dealing with it. Those of us who've been around longer than others, it's our responsibility as senior members of this profession to do something about it, and it's an important it's important for me. Even though PepsiCo is a large company with over $60 billion in annual revenue, you know, we are not a bottomless pit, and like everyone else in the company, I have to be mindful of what we spend to deliver legal services to the corporation. So you're right, that's a huge issue. What do I look for in a person that we may want to hire? Obviously, the first thing is whether or not this person is a good lawyer, a good, sound, technical lawyer in his or her area. We tend to hire more than I like at most level specialists, although from time to time we would hire a very solid generalist from another corporation. I think references, if it's the person that I'm making the employment decision on, If I don't know that person, the references are going to be critical, because I've been around a long time, and I do know a lot of lawyers. And at that point, if it's going to be important for me to get the kind of reference that I thought that Judge Bell said, does this person take care of his or her clients? Does this person have a really good reputation in the legal community as being solid, a solid person? So that's going to be very important to me.
Great.
Well, this has been just a terrific discussion, so I hope you'll join me in thanking both Larry and Sara.